dear brothers and sisters, parishioners of Good Shepherd, those that are following us online. First of all, thank you for make this subscription, make this reflection possible, makes the daily mass possible. We are very happy. It's a lot of work, but we are very happy to serve you. Today I'm going to speak a little bit about punishment. Last week I saw a video. Somebody sent me a video from Italy because the situation in Italy is very difficult. And they sent a video of a famous person, I'm not going to say his name. But basically at the end, he saw on what's going on this virus, he saw a punishment of God. I refuse to believe that, and I want to see what the church says about it. And a simple person also from the parish asked, Father, is God punishing the world? Meaning, it's a question that many people have, but we are afraid to go in, we are afraid to meditate. So this small reflection that I'm going to do is to see a little bit. I understand that the world, we don't like, not even the sound of the word, punishment. You already, also, if you go to Netflix, you see the Punisher. So this guy with a gun there, you already are scared. And it's very easy to make the association with God. And it's not so. The problem here, dear brothers and sisters, is not if God punish or not punish. The problem is first to understand what does it mean punishment in the scripture. Or what does it mean punishment for Jesus Christ? Before going there to the scripture, because it's fundamental, I hope that these days you have more contact with the scripture, because as the psalmist says many times, the scripture is a light. It has the power to enlighten our history. It has the power to enlighten your relationship with your children, with your father. The scripture is a strong light. It's a strong light. But before going to the scripture, I'm going to do a daily life analysis on punishment. You know, St. Thomas, I like him very much. I used to study him a lot. St. Thomas, when he speaks about the eternal law, I did a little paper on that many years ago, he speaks about the eternal law, the divine law, and he speaks about the natural law. The natural law is a participation on the divine law, and the natural law is written in the heart of every man, and part of this natural law also guarantees the order of things in the world. And then he says, of course, when you break this law, following this law, there is a punishment, consequence of your actions. This is natural. It's almost obvious. There is this kind of consequence. To help the person to go back to order, because natural law, everything is about order, and also to help to keep the order in society. The concept of justice has to be applied. For example, in the daily life, because if I speak like that, maybe in the daily life, sometimes it's very important that parents, sometimes you have to punish your child. Maybe you don't use this word, but if your child does something, like I was using this example, if your child steals from you your credit card and go and use as he wish in the internet, in Amazon Prime, or whatever he wants, and comes a bill to you, and the guy is only 16 years old, if you are a good father, what do? You punish him a little bit. You have to understand, because punishment awakens the conscience. He has to understand that something is not right. But the problem here is not so much to understand the punishment. It's not so much what I'm doing. But in moral theology, it's very important the word why. What is the intention? I can punish somebody out of anger, because I hate you and I want punishment. But a father punishment is different. I punish you because I care for you. That's what the scripture says. A father that loves their children, correct them. So this is one kind of punishment. That's the natural punishment. That is very much understood. Also, for example, imagine your child, that those that has not yet the use of reason. They do not understand the natural law. The boy of 16 years old, he already understand. But a 4 years old may not understand. If certain times, in certain occasion, if he take a fork and go to plug there, he's putting himself in danger. And for you to help this child to understand that he's putting himself in danger, you have to get a little bit angry at him. Because we not understand logical argument. The mother has to do a face, don't do it. And you do twice, don't do it. So, you see, it seems a simple example, but it's not. Anger is a kind of anger that corrects. It's a good kind of anger. I don't know if you ever thought about it. It's a good kind of anger. When the Bible speaks about the wrath of God, it's not the wrath that we are thinking, that God is angry. No, no, no. It's always, say the letter to the Hebrew, is a pedagogical anger. It's a pedagogical, because God is looking for the salvation of every man. Saying that, let us go a little bit, let us navigate on the scripture, you know, make a little bit, see what the scripture speak about punishment. Just few things, because we don't have much time. For sure, in the scripture, many times appears the word punishment. I was studying the Greek, for you to have an idea. In the New Testament appears, I count, more than 50 times the word punishment. And in Greek, it appears 10 words, or more than 10. I identify 10 by myself, one by one. 10 words. For example, I read something for you for my research. In Greek, there is a word called timore, that used for chastisement. Dike, for justice. Kalosu, used to punish, but means to prune. It's interesting, this definition. Punishment as pruning. You are pruning, you say pruning? Prune, like when you have a tree, and you want the tree to have many fruits, you have to prune. Somehow, you have to punish. The meaning of the words are very important. We have another word that is paragizo, that let not the sun go down on your anger. It's a different kind of anger. It's not the same anger that the Greek used for the anger of God. You see, when you keep going and going and going, but and it's interesting, when I was scrutinizing the gospel, there is a anger of the Pharisees and Herod and the Pharaoh in the Old Testament. This word they use for this kind of anger is different from the anger of Jesus Christ. It's very interesting. This the terminology is tumos. The anger that speak about God is orge. That is a different kind of... Anyways, I don't want you to get bored with all this definition, but I think it's very interesting so that you may understand the complexity of our subject, the complexity. So in the scripture, going to the scripture, in the scripture is very clear that God punishes people, but punish these people always thinking that the people will go back to him. Says very clear, Jeremiah says very clear, Yahweh say, I have punished Israel. And Israel understood that in two moments, in the desert, today's reading, people were murmuring, and God allowed the serpent to bite them so that they may realize their murmuring, and in the exile. The exile was a word of God for the people. In exile, people meditate. They realize the inclination towards sin. They understood they have abandoned the Lord, and they desire conversion, and they desire to go back, and they are waiting for the Messiah. Because it's very... Here we can see two things. That punishment in the Bible is a consequence of the sin of the people, but also we see very clear here that the punishment also is connected with admonition for people to convert. And the old mentality is very interesting. The old mentality was that, because you may say, let me go back here. You may say, somebody may say, God is punishing the people. But attention, the one that is punished is always the one that has done evil, breaking the law or doing something. This somehow deserves the punishment. Because if you say that, we will open here a very deep, mysterious window. How about those that are innocent? So here we have another question. Would God punish the innocent? Absolutely not. And why the innocent has to suffer? This is the cornerstone question for many people, even for those that are atheists. Friedrich Nietzsche used to say, why the suffering of the innocent? If God exists, doesn't do nothing, he's a monster. If he could do something, he doesn't do it, He's a monster. I don't need this God. If he loves the people, but he does not do it, he's powerless. I don't need this God. Therefore, for me, God is dead. That is the sophism of Nietzsche. That's why in the Old Testament they have this mentality. But here, to help us, I cannot go deeper in everything, but to help us a little bit understand the suffering of the innocent, this great mystery, because it's a mystery. I tell you something, in these days, if you want to read something very deep about suffering, read the encyclical of John Paul II, Salvific Dolores. There he gives a beautiful meaning on the suffering. And he's speaking that encyclical about the figure of Job. Job, because I have here my two assistants here. Job is an innocent man. He has done nothing wrong. Nothing. Suddenly, tragedy hits him. They were in a party and they come to say, one of your son died. And then a few minutes later, one of your daughter died. And then the other died. All his children died. His house was destroyed. He lost all his flock. And at the very end, he got a sickness. He spent the whole day scratching himself. Got a sickness. And then three of his friends comes and say, what have you done? Because this kind of punishment was always associated with a sin. What have you done? And this is the main question that people have. Even Shakespeare, in one of his theater, he asked the same question. What have we done to deserve a such a terrible death? If only thing that we did was good on this earth, what have we done? And Job remained silent. He said, I have done nothing wrong. I understand what you're trying to say. But he defend, saying, I'm innocent. And the three young men accuses him. The book does not give us magical answer. At the very end, God restored his life. And then he says something very profound. Before I knew you for hearsay, now I know you because I have touched you. I know you now. So even though Job does not give an answer, this book put in crisis this theory of retribution, that if I'm good, I can reward. If I'm bad, I can punish. The book shakes this a little bit. And taking the same trend, we see Jesus Christ. Let us ask Jesus Christ what he thinks about punishment or about natural catastrophe. There is one episode a few weeks ago that we proclaimed in the church that was the man born blind. The disciples asked Jesus, Lord, who has sinned? Whose fault is that? Because blindness was a punishment because of somebody's sin. In the natural religious mentality, who has sinned? Jesus Christ answered, nobody. He disassociates, I don't know if you follow me. He disconnects this mentality. Nobody sin. Neither he, neither his parents. This is to be manifested the glory of God. The glory of God will be manifest in him. This is the first answer of Jesus Christ. We could go deeper, but we can't here. Second answer. When the episode when Pilate mingled the blood of some Galileans with the sacrifices, and they come to complain to Jesus. And then Jesus make another interpretation. And Jesus said, do you think they were worse? No. And we think, and Jesus himself says, in this beautiful example, the second answer, do we remember the tower of Siloé or Siloam? It falls, natural catastrophe. Nobody's fault. It falls and kills 18 men in Galilee. Jesus Christ says, do you think those that die, they're worse than everybody else in Jerusalem? Absolutely not. But if you do not convert, something worse will happen to you. Jesus Christ doesn't say if come or not come from God. Jesus Christ says in the Gospel, I come and I come to judge no one. The judgment of Christ is forgiveness for those that are repent. But Jesus Christ says, when we see these things, when you see what's going on in the world, is a call to convert. It's a call for conversion. If men convert, then that's salvation for men. It's amazing what the Catechism of the Catholic Church says. You want to follow from home is number 1472. It says the Catechism of the Church. I have here the other version. It says here. The Catechism of the Church speak about two kinds of punishment, the eternal punishment and the temporal punishment, always for consequence of sin. But it ends, the quotation ends, says something very interesting. This punishment must not be conceived as if it was a vengeance from God. No, no, no. And the Catechism says that when there is conversion, true conversion, punishment is removed. If people convert, will be no more punishment. This is the teaching of the church. Since the Council of Trent, also the Catechism of the Church, and the doctrine of the church. It speaks about this temporal and eternal punishment. But conversion takes away every punishment. For this, dear brothers and sisters, I know it's a very short talk, but I wish that we may understand the goods that can come from that. The goods that come from what is going on. For sure, the catastrophe of all this virus, it calls us all to conversion. Makes us humble. Many understand that he's not a God. That we are not a semi-God. Also, it forces us, everything that shakes my foundation, it forces me to think about the realities that will never be shaken. It forces men to think about a life beyond this earth. It forces us to speak about the novissimo, what is waiting for every man. That is death, judgment, hell, or heaven. That's why, in this sense, is a time for us to think about our own sins and to invoke the forgiveness of God. The wrath of God has fallen upon one man on the cross, an innocent man. That is the fulfillment of the figure of Job. That's our job, the wrath of God. And in Christ, God has forgiven us. That's why St. Paul says something very deep, and I want to finish with that. St. Paul says that the reason Christ has freed us from the wrath of God. The reason Christ. Christ is risen. And his love was superior to our sins. It was superior to punishment. The risen Lord is alive. And he comes in this Easter. So, dear brothers and sisters, do not be afraid. Do not be afraid. Because the love of God wins all. Love always wins. Always wins. May God bless you. The Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.